So I have Lubomir. Welcome, Lubomir and Luca. Hey, Luca. Maria. Hey, Maria. Okay. Good. Great. Okay, I would say first of all, welcome. I'll give another maybe few minutes so that other colleagues from different countries can join. Can we have an update on the countries that are presented? So can you kindly write down from what country you are so that we have an idea with whom we are talking today? Hola Martin, ¿qué tal? Tatiana, здравствуй, как ты? Okay, I'm experiencing some problems with the connectivity, so it might be that this is not working very well. We'll see in case that the audio, the Wi-Fi connection and the internet connection do not work properly, we could also reschedule this. Veselin, can you hear me? Raquel, can you hear me? Hola, Raquel, can you hear me? Super. Can you turn on your microphone to see if everybody can hear you also? Well, I cannot hear, definitely. I cannot hear Veselin. Anybody could hear Veselin? So it might be a problem with your mic, Veselin. Raquel, can you test? Can you please test your microphone just to be sure that we can also hear you? Okay, you can try to switch the computer, Veselin. Meanwhile,
Do you hear me also? No.
Okay, so let's go to the introduction. Meanwhile, Ilan will try to solve the mic issue with Raquel. So one more time, a microphone check, and then we start. Can you please type who is hearing me loud and clear, just to be sure that I am back. Okay, can you hear me now? Is better? Good. So the background noise is off, yes? Okay, so if everybody can hear me, I'm going to start, and if there are any problems or I'm speaking too fast, please let me know, okay? Okay, guys, can you hear me? Okay, it seems like we are experiencing some IT issues. So I'm going to ask one more time for the check. Martin, can you hear me? Tatiana, can you hear me? Good. So welcome everybody. This is the first session of the online training stages of the student contest. My objective for today's presentation is to allow you an idea about the student contest itself and how can you integrate and how you should approach this contest. So before anything else, I would like to give you some information about the contest itself. I have Lubomir who told me that you can hear me okay. I have Martin who told me that you can hear me. What about the others? Okay. Good. So back to the presentation. So which is the objective of the Multi-Comfort House student contest? The primary objective is to diffuse the energy efficiency. So we are speaking about sustainable design. We are speaking about multi-comfort concept. And we are looking at the different dimensions of comfort, such as thermal, acoustics, or indoor. And this contest, it's addressed to architectural and engineering students. You can see here some of the universities that participated or participate during the years. And just to give you a little idea, okay. Can you hear me? I'm experiencing some strange things here with this presentation. Okay. Somebody is playing with the question and answers. Okay, just to give you an idea about how the contest itself is structured, Lubomir, what are the main stages, how you could address them, and to answer to some of the most frequent asked questions, as well as if everything goes well with the IT issues, to be able to pursue one of the pillars of the contest, I would say, which is the Madre. The Madrid Revitalization Project, which is going to be made, presentation is going to be made by Raquel, who is working in the Madrid municipality, and she will give you more information about this so that you can include it in your task. Would this be clear up to now? Okay, so the contest itself last year was launched in 23 countries. We had about 1,600 registered students representing a little bit over 100 universities, so that you can have an idea. And these were the countries and the students registered for the national stage. There is a second stage, which is the international one, where the winners from the different national stages participate all together, and they compete in this stage for the first prizes. So in 2016, the 12th international edition, which was held in Minsk, we had 54 teams from 34 universities, 31 nationalities, and a little bit over 170 participants. The winners, you can see here, last year were coming from Bulgaria, from South Africa, and the third prize went to Romania. But there were also some special prizes for Belarus, for Finland, a special prize from the French embassy to Romania, and another special prize from the dealer to Turkey. Now, speaking about the national stages, which is basically the first step, this is held, it's being organized by ISOVER and ISOCHAM organization in about 24 countries this year. And this puts together the participants from different local universities to compete so that we pick up the best projects. Also, this year, We are having an online entry stage for the students which are learning in countries where the contest is not organized at a national stage. And I'm going to come back to that and tell you a little bit more about this. If you are having colleagues or friends which are students and they are learning, I don't know, in some in a country which is not organizing the national stage this year, like for example in Italy, you can tell them that they can register for the competition online, and there is a parallel level which is also picking up the best team and takes it to the international stage. Furthermore, all these winners we are gathering together for what is called the international stage, and there all together you get to present your projects in front of a jury, and afterwards the jury will deliberate about which one is the best project and to award the prizes. Speaking about the prices at the national stage that are depending on your local organization. If it would be in Colombia, then it is over Colombia and they might have some local prices. If it is in Ukraine, it's Ukraine which is deciding upon this. However, once you've made it to the international stage, there is a set of prices which you can see here, and also very important, all of this information you can also find in the task of the event. I was saying earlier that there is this online entry stage which is also awarding three prizes. This is open to all students, independent of their formation, which are learning in this year, 2016-2017, in universities which are situated in countries that do not organize national stages. All the countries which are organizing national stages are here. All the others are not organizing. Therefore, for example, as I already mentioned, if you are having friends in Denmark for Erasmus study, or you are having colleagues in Italy, they can also join this competition and take part in the online entry stage, which is awarding also three prizes, and the winners, they are also the winners of the online entry stage, they are also invited to participate to the international stage. Do you hear me? Clear? Is this clear what I'm saying? It is important for me, guys, it is important for me to give me your feedback, because I'm speaking in front of a computer. I don't know how well you can hear me, if I'm speaking maybe too fast, or if I'm not speaking clear enough. So that's why please have an interaction with me. It's very important also for the speaker to have your feedback. Good. Now, I was mentioning about the event about the international stage presentation. I strongly suggest you to go on the website of the contest, which is www.isover-students.com, and to take a look at the previous year's presentation. This will give you a pretty good idea about how different teams from different countries designed their project and presented it, and it will also give you an idea about what is the procedure of the international stage. As for this particular point, each of the teams last year or last edition, as I already mentioned, we had 54 teams. Each of the teams got 5 minutes, and that's all, 5 minutes by the clock. You can see it in the video, to present their projects. And for example, you are having here all the years from 2016 till 2005 with the presentation. And for the last years, you are also having the videos. And you can see, for example, in this is the case of Czech Republic, we are having the first prize, the second prize, and the third prize. And for each of these prizes, you can all see on one hand the PowerPoint presentation that they presented during the proceedings, but also you are having the live broadcast, well, the registration, the recordings of the live broadcast and of their performance during last edition. So on stage, we are broadcasting this live so that everybody can see it from different countries, and you can see their performance. Now, to speak a little bit about this year edition, I'm pretty sure that everybody knows about the task. The task is the urban regeneration of a community in Madrid. And the task has been drafted in close collaboration with Ayuntamiento de Madrid, which basically means the city of Madrid or the municipality of Madrid. And the first objective that each of you should have would be to make it and to win one of the positions that allow you to participate to 31st of May, 1st of June and 2nd of June next year to the international stage in Madrid. Now, how many of you have already read fully the contest task? Nobody? Wow, I was hoping that some of you would have read the contest task by now. Okay. Anybody else? Okay, so I think that then this presentation will be quite helpful so that you can have a clear picture of the different parts. Now, the task itself, this regeneration, it refers to a community situated within the perimeter of Gran San Blas area in Madrid. And most of the buildings are buildings realized during early 1950s. They were designed as sleeping rooms, or basically they were designed as dwellings for all the workers and all the staff which were working in a close by factory, which is the Pegasus factory. And we are going to upload, there is already a lot of information about this. If you didn't read it, I suggest you do it. You will see a few information about it. Your main objective will be to think about sustainable architecture, taking into account the urban space, will be to respond to the Saint-Gobain multi-comfort criteria as they are described in the contest task, to take into consideration the MADRE, which is the official revitalization program of the city of Madrid, to think about the regional context of it, and not and last but not least, to think about the social and economical aspects so that you can give to this area a new impulse. This is very, very briefly the task description. I'm pretty sure that many of you are having questions. If you want to ask something, please use the chat. I'll try to answer to your questions to the best of my abilities. Now, one thing that we did in order to support you was to provide as much information as possible so that you can interpret this task and to think about it. Now, any of you read the site experience document which was uploaded on the contest task? This document, Teachers Day in Madrid, proceedings, feedback. Well, it seems that not so many of you. I suggest to read this document. Basically, what we did was to invite a number of professors from different countries, and we went together to see the site of the contest. And following this visit, site visit and so on, you will find plenty of information about the task, the way that the teachers perceived the place, and some of their feedback. Can you hear me? Good. Following this visit, site visit with the teachers, we had about 25 teachers. We drafted this document, which you can find also in the website of the contest. And we came out with a statement, if you wish, which is written here, which you can all take a look at it, which says basically that you are allowed to interpret, or you should allow, or you should interpret the task in both the letter and the spirit of it. So on one hand, within the boundaries of the task, which is buildings 1 and 2 and plot 1, 2, 3, 4, you can interpret the requirements taking into account first, targeting comfort of the inhabitants, and secondly, increasing the attractiveness of the building and the nearest surrounding. This is one on one side. On the other side, within the spirit of the task, if you feel the need to take a wider approach to the area, integrating in the project the shift, the future shift of the population in the decades to come, you can do that, but make sure that you are not disrupting the neighborhood. Is this clear for everybody? Okay, now some frequently asked questions, some of them already have been sent to me by different students, they are already answered here. For example, can we remove the storage spaces? Yes, but you need to think about doing some storage spaces if you demolish the ones in the area 1, 2, 3. Can we change the floor plans and provide... You can change the floor plans and you need to provide argumentation for the actions, but you can only do so, change the floor plans within the boundaries of the apartments, because these apartments are inhabited by people. And most of the time, these people are the ones, the people that are living there are also the owners. You need to provide a connection. You are entitled, if you feel like, to change the ground floor and to say, okay, at the ground floor, we would like to propose a new functionality. No problem, you can do that. But if you do so, then you have to think about providing a living space for the people that were living at the ground floor. So basically, you will need to build something up. Somebody asked me, how many stories can we put on top of the three existing ones? The answer is here. It is up to you to decide how many you put, and of course it is up to you to give an explanation about why you are doing such a thing. The inhabitants which are living there, which are basically owning the apartment, they have to continue to live there once the renovation is done. And just to give you an idea, because somebody else asked me, what is the split of the population? About 70%, 70 to 75% of the inhabitants are old people. And in average, a single apartment is inhabited by two persons. Somebody else asked me, what is the requirements for new for renovation in square meters? Well, there is no requirement for renovation. However, there is a requirement for new living area, and it's about 30 square meters per person. So this, so you can have an idea about different issues. Furthermore, The preservation of the facade was not considered because the facade is not having any historical meaning, if you wish so. If you feel that for your architectural gesture, preservation of the facade is needed, then you can also do so. And last but not least, when we are speaking about the static and structural conditions, we choose to not look extremely well at them to give you a little bit of freedom. But bear in mind that the longitudinal load-bearing brick wall, it's basically longitudinal load brick walls are the bricks which are giving the static. So the thick walls of the facade and the middle thick brick wall of the building. Are these explanations clear enough? Did everybody understand them? We did not look, we are not asking any specific calculation for the money, Lubomir. However, within the analysis of the project, you can be sure that the judges, both local and at the international, will look at the sustainability. So from this point of view, everything that you will design should be argued. If there is an argumentation for a more expensive investment, then this can be accepted. But if you propose something without any argumentation, then it's not okay. Thank you. So coming back to this, I strongly suggest that each and every one of you reads this. Here are the words of the teachers who went there with us, who took the work, who spoke with the owners. Some of these teachers are most likely your teachers, because we had teachers from Ukraine, we had teachers from Bulgaria, we had teachers from Slovakia, from Czech, and so on. And what I did was to put together all their feedback, try to change it as little as possible, and give you their feelings, their perceptions, so that you can have a very good indication of the perception of the task. Furthermore, speaking about what is next for us, I'm sure that you are all well aware of the schedule. The key once in your case would be the fact that the completion of the national stages will be ready by 1st of May. I'm pretty sure that most of you will be ready by then. And then, of course, we are having these two sessions of online trainings. Yes, all the online trainings will be uploaded online. The first session starts now. I hope you received all the information. The second session will start in January, February. The scope of these trainings, if you wish, is to give you as many information possible on one hand about the task, and on the other hand about the different dimensions of comfort, either acoustics, either thermal, speaking about air quality or speaking about light. All of you, I hope, have received this email from the registration. Can you please confirm me that you received this email showing the schedule of the different trainings? Guys, can you please confirm me that you received this? Thank you, Anastasia. Где ты? Украина или Беларусь? Отлично. Спасибо. So, thank you so much to all of you. Furthermore, I was talking about the fact that the online trainings are recorded. If you would like to take a look at the previous online trainings, you can find all of them in the section which is called Past Contest. And not only that, you find there the international stage winners or the national stage winners with the projects and so on, but you can also find the task, the documentation from previous year, and of course the online trainings. Now, in terms of sources, you have already the isover-students.com. This is the official website, and here all the information will be posted. And you also have isover-construction.com. This is a database where you can find plenty of construction details, the multi-comfort house designer, construction tool, brochures, movies, and so on. All of this intended so that you can have the most of the information, or as many information as possible, so that you can proceed with the project. I'm not going to spend too much time on the previous year's experience. You can take a look for the different tasks that we had. You can see we had a renovation in 2010, then we had a skyscraper, sustainable community, then we went for Glückstein Quartier in Germany, then we had the School of Tomorrow for Gaziantep. Heinrich, if you would like to have a question, the easiest way is that you can write it here. Otherwise, it's quite tricky to give the voice over because we are getting into the microphone effect. Okay, so this was 2014. 2015, we went in Astana in Kazakhstan for residential, and last year we went in Best for also community development. Furthermore, if you need to ask some information, you have you can address it to me. You will find both of these contacts on the website, or also you will find it in the contest tasks. Speaking about this, Ilyan, can you please set up Veselin as a presenter, and let's see if his mic is functioning. Veselin, can you test your mic so you can see if everything is okay?
Do you hear me, guys? Hello.
We hear you loud and clear. Can you all please confirm that you can hear Veselin?
Okay, this is perfect then. Hi guys.
Great. So I'm going to make just a brief introduction so that you know with whom are you talking, and then I will let Veselin tell you a little bit about the contest task. Veselin, it's helping me with this year task. He's a former winner of the student contest. If my memory serves me well, it was back in 2009. Yes, Veselin?
Yeah, that's right. 2009.
Yeah, so he won at the international stage, and I kindly asked him to support me with all the information and tasks, and he's going to give you an idea also about the architectural features of the task. This being said, he's an architect, but he's also a passive house certified designer, so he knows when he's speaking about energy efficiency. So now I'm going to turn off my mic and let Veselin briefly present you the architectural parts of the task.
Hello again, dear colleagues. Nice to have you here. I see already some guys also from Bulgaria. Good to have you here. So we start with the site intro. And we speak first about the city. As you know, Madrid is the capital of Spain. It has 3.2 million people inhabitants, only in the city, and 6.5 in the whole metropolitan area. And this makes the city the third biggest city in the European Union. If you have any question in between, you can write it down also, or if you would like to know something, if it's too fast, too slow, not understandable and so on, just let me know. So then we continue with Madrid. This is the city in Europe with the highest number of trees and green areas per inhabitant, of course. And on this graph, here on the left, you can see that Spain is the European country with the highest percentage of people who live in flats and apartments. Almost 65% of the population lives in multifamily houses. So we can say that this contest task this year can be used, let's say, like a model, which can be reproduced also in other parts of the city. So it's like a very, very special task. Which can be multiplied or adopted for other regions of the city. Then we jump to the geographic position and climate. As you can see, Madrid is in the middle of Spain, is in the center of the country, and there is, let's say, the distance from the city and the ocean is, let's say, too long. And that's why we have a semi-dry climate, which is also cold a little bit, especially in the winter months. The altitude is 667 meters above sea level. This is actually the highest capital in the European Union, as far as I know. The warmest month is July. Around 32 degrees Celsius, and the coldest month is January, 6 to 8 degrees. And the temperature changes during the day are very common, so you can have very low temperatures in the morning, and in the evening you can, or during the day you can have a bit higher temperatures. The sunshine duration is very high in comparison to the other parts of European Union. This is a very high level. In compared, I think, to Moscow, we have 2 times more sunshine duration per year. And the rainy days are only 63 per year. Average humidity, it's around 57% per year, and the snowfalls are very rare, maybe 1-2 days in January. So very rare. Just a bit more about the location. This area which Gabriel also mentioned, this Gran San Blas, or how is it called in Spain? I don't know. This is in the east part of the city. You can see it here on the with the red color. And 25% of the inhabitants are elder people, 30% are not educated people, and the value of these two buildings is approximately 40% lower than the average value of other buildings in the city. And of course, they don't meet any energy efficiency requirements. And this is actually the quarter where the buildings are located. You can see you have here one street on the north, one street on the south, and this is the quarter. These are the two buildings in orange. Now I put some color up also. And this is the area where you have to plan the contest and design your ideas. The scope of the test car, those two buildings, also the inner courtyard and the park which is on the south. We'll see this also on the next slides. And the building height is 3 stories plus 1 ground floor. And here you have, as Gabriel mentioned, this was a village for the workers in the factory. And here you have buildings for the engineers, for the former engineers in this factories, and these were buildings for the management. Single family houses, and these are multi-family houses again. We have here one aerial view of the site and the buildings. As you can see, the two buildings are here. And this is one site photo, or just photo of the site. You can see here the park. This is the inner courtyard, which is close also by some storage buildings on the both east and west facades. And you have here one street, which we will see also on the next slide. This is one drawing of the site plan. You can see again here the two buildings, building one, building two. They are actually divided in 3 sections, so to say. You have here the inner courtyard in between, and these two storage spaces on west and east. Then you have here the park. This is the park on the south. You have here this street. And you have here some parking spaces, of course, around the street, also on the north side. There are no problems with the parking. Set one inhabitant of the building, so this is already decided how to do the parking. On the next slide, we can see one section and the ground floor plans. First, let me just show you the terrain, how is it going. The terrain is a bit higher on the south side, as you can see, and it's going a bit down on the north. And if we jump back to the site plan, you can see you have here some stairs. Here are also additional stairs and one ramp. And you have here stairs also. So this is the way that the difference in the levels are made. So let's go back to the floor plans. This is so to say one building section. North building. This is the north. Yeah. This is the south building, and every building has 3 sections, as we already mentioned. This is here the entrance. We have one staircase, and we have one apartment on the left side and one apartment on the right side. Very simple solution, so to say. And it is the same with the building on the north, it's just mirrored on the other side. And on the section, we can say that we have here the ground floor and the three floors. Additionally, we have one basement floor, which is only 1.40 meter high. This is one space for water and canalization installations. So it's unheated space, and we have this unheated attic space. And probably I think most of you will remove this and put some new buildings above. Maybe some small house also, or one separate floor. Speaking of some new floors which can be added, maybe in this building you can add one floor or maybe something more. Because of the sun shading, you should also analyze the sun shading from this building into the courtyard and to the other building. Maybe here you can put some small house, something like this. You can decide, and this is the inner courtyard of the two buildings. Now there are all these storages, you can see them. These are actually, this is everything storage. You'll see also pictures. So you can remove this and put something in addition. But you should provide storage spaces for the inhabitants. If we go to the typical floor plan of the two buildings, we can see that where we had the entrance, above we have terraces for the inhabitants of the two apartments, the two dwellings, and we have one bigger bedroom. Here we have actually one kitchen, this is one bedroom, this is a living room, and here we have two small rooms. This is the typical plan of the apartments. Guys, do you have any questions so far? Maybe not, okay. Then we go to the architectural details of the existing building. This is the ground floor detail, as you can see. Here we have this unheated technical space, which is only 1.40 meter high. We have concrete walls against ground. We have concrete slab here to the ground floor, and above we have bricks. 29 centimeters with exterior and interior plaster. And this is actually the detail. Of course, if you make some renovation, you can put either some interior insulation or some exterior insulation, or maybe both. You can also insulate the floor step, so to say. So I'm just giving you also some help and some hints. Here you have also some thermal conductivity of the materials. You have also here the materials written with the thicknesses. Then we go to the next detail. For some reason it's there is some problem with this detail. It wasn't so in the presentation, but yeah, what to do? Yeah, it's written somehow, but it should be in this other direction. It was so, and you can see these are the bricks, the exterior wall with bricks, and this is the concrete slab. So the load-bearing construction, as Gabriel mentioned, it's made from bricks. Let me just show you. These are the longitudinal walls, which are load-bearing in this direction. And they should be preserved, of course. You can make some openings in them. Maybe you can make some steel frame where you make an opening and so on. And more or less these interior small walls can be changed in one way or another. So when we jump then to the next detail, this is the roof detail. You can see the brick walls here, and you have this concrete slab for the attic space. Attic space is unheated, as we mentioned already, and you have one roof with roof tiles and this ceramic bricks, which made the exterior roof, so to say. And you can see here the roof ridge, how it's made. Yeah, probably most of you will remove this, all these bricks and this roof, and put a new roof and make some new solution design. If we check the photos, this is one view from the west. Let me just jump back to the site plan. So this is view actually from here where I'm making this yellow, yeah, actually maybe here. And you see this, the two buildings and this storage space. Here is the storage space in this area and the two buildings. You can see also the sun shading some weeks ago, or the sun shadow, so to say. On the next image, you have one view from the south. You can see the entrance of the south building. This is the entrance on the left side, let's say the west side. And you can see here this street between the park, which is here on the side, the south, and the building, the south building. And on the right image, you have actually almost the same view, but it's a bit more sunny, maybe in the summer. On the next images, you can see you have one view from the south and southeast, so to say. You can see here the park also, as well, on this image. And you can see these other buildings on the east side of our design buildings or our contest buildings. And here you can see the difference in the levels. You have here actually some stairs, actually here, yeah. And you can see that these facades are blind facades, and on the other facades you have almost the same raster, so to say. Almost squared windows on the facades to the courtyard, and also on the other facade to the street. On the next images, you can see one photo from the north side. Here you have the street on the right, and this is the building with the building entrance and the terraces here. And here you have one view from the west into the inner courtyard between the two buildings. You can see here you don't have any terraces. This is the volume of the staircase here also, and these typical facades with almost square windows, square sized windows. This is one view from the park. It's actually a very nice park with some palm trees and other big trees. It should be more or less preserved, but you can make some changes or small architecture pavilions or whatever. And this is one view from the other street on the south, where you can see the south building. The next photos show us the inner courtyard between the two buildings and the interior of the entrance, plus the staircase inside. As you can see, the inner courtyard is full with these old storage spaces, which probably will be removed but somehow replaced in your design solution. You can see here the difference between the two sections of the building. It's clearly visible here. And from the interior, you can see that you don't have completely accessibility for disabled people. You have here some stairs. There is no place here for elevator, so you should design something which is suitable also for people with disabled activities. And speaking of, again, of the contest task, the goal is to increase the living comfort of the inhabitants and to transform this zone into an attractive and desired space for young couples, more or less. You can see here again the two buildings and these four main zones. Speaking about the buildings, you should create a vision, architectural vision, and increase the comfort considering the accessibility. As I showed you, you need to provide horizontal access to every living unit with an elevator, maybe with some ramps also. You need to improve the thermal comfort of the building. So this means in general to reduce the energy consumption for heating and cooling. And of course, for the climate in Madrid, you have to provide suitable sun shading for the south facades. The next comfort point is air quality. You need to provide constant flow of fresh air with ventilation system. Visual comfort. You should increase the hours with natural sunlight. Then comes the acoustic comfort. You need to reduce the levels of noise inside the apartments. And the last slide is about these other three zones, actually four zones. Three of them are more related to the building, these three zones with storage spaces, which we saw. And zone number four is the park. So you can partly or fully remove these storage spaces, but you should provide additional storage spaces for the inhabitants and their needs. And in the inner courtyard, you can design public spaces, which can be semi-open or glazed. You can design also pavilions, underground parking or underground storage, or some other functions which you decide. Also on the facades of the building, you can make additional elements like terraces or some containers or some storage spaces or on these blind facades. It's up to you to decide. As we said about the park, it should remain unchanged. But, however, you can propose some different solutions for the park elements or maybe some architectural elements inside this zone. And last but not least, as Gabriel mentioned, the project should be realistic. So this means economic feasibility of the project. It should be realistic. Some futuristic design would be nice also, but maybe from an economic point of view, it will be not so good. So you should keep also this in mind. Good design with the possibility to be realized in some economical balance. And this is also very important. The inhabitants will continue to live in the dwellings after the renovation, so maybe you need to optimize the construction process if you make some big changes in the apartments, or maybe you can put some other temporary living spaces for the inhabitants. So thank you. If you have any questions,
So first of all, thank you, Vasilin. Just I would like to underline one thing that Vasilin said. Bear in mind that if you think about proposing some kind of solutions, those people which are living there, they should have some kind of place where to live. So this being said, I just bought I just go give the mic to Raquel, but first let me thanks to Veselin. Thank you so much for everything, Veselin. If you have any questions, yeah, super. If you have any questions, please write it down. Ilian, can you please take off Veselin as presenter and set up Raquel as presenter? Let's see if the microphone and everything works properly. Hola Raquel, let's see if the mic is working.
Hi, can you hear me now? Hi, is it working? Hi, hi, can you hear me now? Is it working?
Yes, Raquel, it's working. I'm just taking off my mic so that there is no microphone in.
Great.
Please speak a little bit closer to the microphone, because if you speak too far away, there is a slight issue with the mic, but in principle, we can hear very well.
Okay, I will start. As Gabriel explained, we launched this Plan Madre, which means Madrid recovers, and translate like a model plan. The motto is recover your home, recover your neighborhood, and recover your city. When I had this general overview on our city, but I think you've already got those numbers. Madrid has 3.2 million people, but the whole metropolitan area, it's more than 6 million people. It's been the center of many activities. It's the biggest city in population in Spain. For the last decade, the urban model we had was an extensive one. They tried to urbanize the whole area of the city. And that's what we faced when we get to the city government, which was a year and a half ago. But now we are facing this end of demographic growth, and many of those areas will be empty and will never go out. And the existing city is the yellow area you can see over here, and then in dark color are all the new developments. The only two white areas are protected areas because of natural reasons. So the model we propose is a new urban model which is more social, more sustainable, and in which people decide the world for their city. And the most important thing is that we focus on the existing city. And mainly on this area you can see here in pink, which are all those peripheral neighborhoods surrounding the very heart of the city center, what we call the central Almond. Because it's been almost abandoned for 40 years. And then there's an emergency for investment on all these areas. I don't know if you're listening to me okay, if I can get some feedback or whatever. The first thing we made was an urban study with four indicators related with the vulnerability of those areas. We chose these four, you can see here, the first two ones are related to the buildings, the aging of the buildings, and the price, the value, because there's a huge difference between a flat in the city center of Madrid and a flat in those peripheral neighborhoods. It could be up to 10 times more expensive or cheaper in according to where you are. And the two second ones are related with the population. The first one has to do with the percentage of uneducated people, and the second one is related with the aging of the population. That, as I mentioned before, we're facing this extreme age problem in Spain. Altogether with these four indicators, we establish this map. This is a map of preferential areas. I hope everything is okay and you're listening to me. Okay. I'll try to speak more slowly. Maybe it would be easier. I was mentioning this map. This is a very important map because it defines the areas which are included in Plan Nadir. It includes 1.3 million people, and that's 38% of Madrid population. Of course, the building of your task is included in one of those areas. We set a round table for rehabilitation where the local government would sit together with with the regional government, the state government, but also the industry, the professionals, the neighbors, the consumers, the ecologists, and everyone who had something to do with rehabilitation, and all together we build what Plan Madrid should be. And we established two main criteria of the works that we wanted to promote. The first one is energy efficiency. In Madrid there is 1.5 million homes, million flats mainly, and 70% of them were built before 1980. That's a very important date because a year before the first insulation regulation was established. So any building built before that date had no insulation at all. That happens with the buildings, with the six buildings in your task. And the second criteria also fits your task because it's accessibility. 40% of the buildings in Madrid have no elevator when they have more than three stories. That includes, as you can see there, 40,000 buildings. We believe that's unacceptable, and those two criteria have a huge potential, and we already know it's a very big demand in our city. The Plan Madrid was launched in July this year. Already more than 17,000 homes have asked for its help to improve their quality lives. Those are the most important figures related with the subsidy itself, with the way we are helping people to improve their homes. This isn't translated, but I think you understand very easily. As I said, our first priority was accessibility, and the subsidy here is 70%, up to 1,000 euros per flat, not the whole building, it's just every flat. The second criteria, which was the second priority in our plan, is energy efficiency, and the percentage of the subsidy depends on how big is the improvement of this energy efficiency. We have this rank with the letters from the A to the G, and when you make it and you improve one letter, then you get 50% of subsidy, and if you get to improve two letters, then you get 60% of the subsidy. The most important thing here is that we don't give money when you only change your heating system or install some renewable energy source. We ask the neighbors that the first measure they do is to improve the insulation. That's the first. Then we can have substitute for many other actions, but the first one is the insulation, including of course the glassing and anything that you need. After that, if you need to make any other kind of any other works in their homes, it is also possible. There are other percentages. For the first time, the taxes are also included, all of them, and it's up to 70%. We've also made a very big effort on making this program very easy and very affordable for anyone. So we try to simplify the document we're asking the communities. We try to minimize the things they should handle to us. As surprising as it may seem, in 2018, we gave the possibility to make an online application, which was never seen before in the city council. And we launched a website with a calculator to check how much was the subsidy you could get, with a search engine where you can find whether your building is or isn't inside this map. We thought that any effort we could make to make it get to the neighbors would be worth it, and yeah, it was proven it was. We made lots and lots and lots of meetings with neighbors. We moved every evening to every of those neighborhoods, also with the industry, with the professionals, and the man who was a stakeholder in this topic. This map shows all the areas we've been. I think we've reached almost everyone who was needed in this map. But as you can see, it's again this shape I showed in the first map, which is something like a beaten donut or something like that. And it includes all those area of buildings that were built in the 70s and 60s as the ones you're working with. We also have this proximity service that included the bus visitors could see when they visit the site, and a neighbor could approach and get the information they needed. We helped them with the filling of the formulas and everything. As far as we first, it's been a succeed. Neighbors now have already asked for this help, and the total investment we think up to with the data I have now, it's 6 million euro, and the public investment will be almost 40 million euro. This is one example of the kind of innovation it's taking place, and I hope you have even better ideas with your task. And this is an example of this improvement in energy efficiency in our work. In Spain, 40% of buildings are an F, so probably yours will be an F or a E. You'll find it very soon with the calculation tool. I think it's already been sent to you. It's an official tool. And in this example, they didn't only improve it one letter, but it was three, from the G to the B. And the savings in conditioning was up to 60%. I think that's all for me. If you have any questions or anything, I'm here to ask you. I think you should take advantage that I will probably be a DJ, so. Mario. Probably they were thinking I would be a much longer presentation. Thank you. Yeah, I think so. We've published it in many places and in our website. You're going to find most of the information. It's going to be in Spanish, so yeah, I will give it to Gabriel and they will give it to you if you want. I think the most important is that you find this task in this whole sense of to a new human level, because those neighborhoods have many qualities but also have been very abandoned, and I think we have this opportunity to avoid people to go away, because what they are facing now is that all those very old people can't live there anymore because they don't have an elevator, they spend too much on conditioning, both in winter and summer. And I think their challenge is to improve those neighborhoods so they can stay. And when I say those neighborhoods, it's both public space, mainly the buildings, because they need update. They were building like 50s or 60s from the last century, and almost nothing has been done since then. Things, Gabriel. I don't know if you have any questions or anyone has.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me, guys? Okay, great. So first of all, thank you so much, Raquel, for taking the time to speak with us. If you have any questions, we are still having about 15 minutes. Feel free to ask. First answer that I'm going to say is that yes, Lubomir, as all this session of presentation will be uploaded online, so on a YouTube channel, so you will be able to see everything, so of course you will get everything. Any other questions, guys? Nobody, no questions, which is normally okay, means everybody understood everything. Thank you so much, Raquel. So guys, if there are no questions, then I will thank to again to Raquel for taking her time to share with us the presentation of Madre. I would equally thank to Veselin for the support in the presentation. Also, I would like to thank to all of you for taking the time into this first session. I would also like to invite you to the next training session, which is going to be Monday, and which is going to be dedicated to the thermal comfort dimension. And this being said, I'm going to thank also to Ilian for all the IT support, and ask him to close the session within 2 minutes, just to give a chance for a last question. If any of you, well, you see, Lubomir, I was pretty sure that is going to be another question. So let's see. Tell us, how, what would you like to know? What do you mean by if we need? No, you don't need to read anything. Don't worry. This is not like some homework or something. We are going to share with you everything that we have. What we are going to do also is that Monday we are going to send to all the students registered an information about these online trainings, about the Teachers Day proceeding with the documents, so that you can have a look at it, and also about the forecast upload of this presentation on the website. So you don't need to read anything. Okay, so thank you so much for taking the time to be here. Looking forward to seeing you for the next online training. As I told you, this is going to be about thermal comfort, and is going to be made in by me together with one of the jury members of the International Stage 2017. It's going to be, it is planned next week, Monday, and it's going to start at 3 o'clock Paris time. See you there. Thank you so much, Ilian. You can close now the room. Thank you all. Bye.